What's up? This is Jamie Madrox from Twiztid, and you're listening to, or watching, depending on whether you got your eyes closed, Interview Under Fire. What I feel lately is 50 shades of hate, me.
What's up, everyone? Welcome back to a new edition of Interview Under Fire. This is your host, Sonny. I'm joined by my co-host, Cory Hodges. Cory, how's it going, man?
What's up?
Nice to have you back here.
Doing good, yeah.
Today, we are with the legendary, and yes, I did mean legendary, considering everything we've talked about recently, Jamie Madrox, man. Quite the honor. Thank you so much for joining our IUF series today. Now, Jamie, this is an exciting time of the year for you and Monoxide with the release of your latest studio album, Electric Lettuce, which recently dropped this past week on Majik Ninja Entertainment. Now, first things first, I want to commend you guys on all the well-deserved recognition it's been getting so far. If there's such a thing as dropping a record on a day like 420, this is how you do it. There's just so much to discover about this record. But before we get to everything and beyond with you and Twiztid, you know, I'm going to ask a very important question to start things off. It's a simple one, but I think it's an important one to ask considering what we've been going through with our lives lately. How are you, man? You know, how's life in Michigan? I think you're in Michigan right now. Is that correct?
Absolutely.
Yeah. How are you, buddy?
I'm doing good. Yeah. No, for what it's worth, we are putting up with whatever needs to be done to keep everything in the rules and regulations of making it fair play and all that goodness. I'm staying healthy and trying to, just keep it pushing, man. I had the junk. So it's like, I know what it's like, the before, the during, and the after.
Cory did too.
So like I have a new perspective on it. And I'm like, I said this before, but, and I keep this with me. Like I have a new, I'm trying to figure out the proper words, a new respect for people's like boundaries. Like I used to be offended. Like, you know, like for example, like if like this is a stupid analogy, but if somebody sneezes and people are like that, you know what I mean? I would be like, wow, what an asshole. But now I'm like, whatever makes you feel safe, I don't judge anymore, because now having it and seeing how people reacted to me when I had it, it was like, what the fuck? I felt like I had the fucking plague. You know what I mean? So it's I get it. And I'm not as, I guess judgy is the words as I was before about, you know, whatever, what have you, washing your hands and hygiene and that kind of thing. I mean, I've always been OCD, but now it's just like, I'm a little more relaxed with it because I don't mind whatever makes you feel safe. Like, I'm good, man. As long as you live and you're happy, that makes me happy. We're all gold, man.
It's so funny you say that, because I was a germaphobe before all this started. And now it's like,
I was too.
Oh, now it's now we're all going to be in the same boat. That's the way I think of it.
I still am. I'm that guy once a week that wipes the door handles on the car with the Windex disinfectant. I'm that guy. You know, hey, man, live and love.
Yeah, all the hand sanitizer companies are just jumping for joy as we're talking.
I mean, Jamie, if
anything, let Jamie from Twiztid endorse you on that. Now, Jamie, I'm glad you're doing well, Jamie. I know we all are making the best of the situations, obviously, doing. But, you know, I want to wind the clock back here to maybe 1997, maybe even years before that. Because here's the thing, IUF and, you know, Interview Under Fire, we have such a diverse fan base, you know, because a lot of our listeners into metal and hip hop and everything else in between. But you guys are also more than just hip hop. So for the people who don't know, if you could just briefly talk about that moment in your life that led to the forming of Twiztid with Monoxide, you know, does everything feel like it also went by in a blink at the same time?
I mean, yes and no. At times it's like, if it wasn't for House of Krazees, it's like a domino effect. Like if it wasn't for Crazy Clan, there wouldn't be House of Krazees. If there wasn't House of Krazees, there wouldn't be Twiztid. There wasn't Twiztid, there wouldn't be Majik Ninja. And then there wouldn't be like the reforming of House of Krazees and fun stuff like that. So it's like, I think it all kind of like laid down like train tracks and we kind of just chugged along with it. But I am, and I'm proud that I was able to go through those steps of life to learn. Cause I think a lot of it was a learning process. I think like life or whatever you believe in, whatever higher power you believe in, you know, I believe God doesn't give you anything that you can't handle, at least in my life. So I feel like when you're ready, when you successfully are ready to move to the next stair step in the staircase, rather, you're like, now I'm ready for it. I wasn't ready for it before. I would have just fell down all the time. You know what I mean? That's how I think.
Yeah.
At least how I like to think. So I can try to justify, you know, like when you work so hard and it doesn't pay off. You know what I mean? Because those times do happen in life. But maybe it just goes to show you that, you know, if you don't know loss, you'll never know win.
Yeah.
Shit like
No, go ahead. I think you were going to say something there.
No. I just, that's just basically like, I think those times in my life where, like, you know, we may have had expectations for House of Krazees that never really seen fruition or stuff like that. Or even like to this day, things that we're just now getting to do with Twiztid that we wanted to do for decades. You know what I mean? Like literally like have our own tennis shoe or have our own toys or, you know, like just do cool stuff, like have our own line of merchandising and clothing and just, you know, be in control of your own destiny. You know what yeah. I mean? I feel that we, Paul and I, and everybody here at M&E are one of those stories where hard work pays off. And I think paying attention to who and how you got there is will do you a service as you go to the right. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah. I feel like, you know, the past couple of years, I thought I knew Twiztid before, you know, but now I really feel like I'm really getting to know you guys. You guys are diving into so much different things. And I feel like I'm getting to know you guys more personal through social medias and stuff like that. And
word up.
That y'all's creativity has a lot to do with that and being able to show it a lot more and use that. It's awesome.
Yeah. I appreciate it. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, you go first, Jamie.
All I was going to say is back in the day, Blaze and I did the hotline, which was like this, you know, number, which wasn't toll free, mind you. And a lot of kids got, you know, scolded by their parents for having running up $200 and calling the hotline every day. But every single day, Blaze and I, it was like a message machine and it allotted 10 minutes. So Blaze and I would record this in real time. And if we fuck up, we'd go back and we'd start again. And we'd start again until we got the whole 10 minutes all the way through. So this would be like a 2-hour process to record 10 minutes. You know, now with the studio, we can do it, you know, whatever. But we're talking real time on a telephone. And we were so into that. And that was the closest thing, I think, at that time. I'm really showing my age here. But at the time, that was the closest thing we had to communication with those who listen, with who we call family and the people that, you know, support us in what we do. And now with the invent of the internet and social media and shit like this right here, it changes the game. I can do it on a daily basis now. I can go hit up some comments and then go to Twiztid and be on Facebook or Instagram. It's like, it's a blessing. It really is, because it's like, and mind you, we can't get to everybody. We're not, you know, whatever, like, but the times that we can and like the emails that we are able to answer and shit like that, I think it's important. I really do, because I'm a firm believer that, you know, like I said before, you know, try until you get what you need. So like you might've sent us 5 emails and the first 5 didn't work, but that 6th one, someone answered you because man, it was meant to be. I don't know. That's just how I try to think of things to keep it pushing, you know?
No, that's well said. And, you know, talking about, you know, how long you've been at this game, you know, 1997, you know, nearly 30 years again, I sound like a broken record, maybe even longer than that. Whether it's with,
I love it.
You know, Twiztid or House of Krazees or Psychopathic Rydas, Dark Lotus, Triple Threat. What am I missing? Samhain, Witch Killers. Like, hopefully I'm getting that list right here.
You got it, man. You got it.
Something I wanted to ask for you, Jamie, you know, you've done some touring, you know, I wanted to ask, how was the live experience, like the music experience for you personally? Cause you've done some extensive touring. You played at, you know, Gathering of the Juggalos, 656, mm-hmm. Warped Tour, Fright Fest, Attack of the Ninjas. I mean, that list goes on and on. And now we've all just kind of been forced to take an unexpected step back. And does it make you have a growing appreciation of the touring life? Cause there's like, we could talk about food, we could talk about culture, we could talk about fans, so many things to pick up about what makes touring amazing. What's your biggest personal takeaway now that, you know, we're kind of here at this point?
I think my takeaway was when we first started, we just wanted to be heard. And then once we were heard, we wanted to be seen and wanted to be remembered. And it's like each time that we would get an opportunity, because when we started off, we used to pay to play. Like we would try to get on people's shows and try to, you know, throw down money so we could be able to get in front of that crowd. And as we go on, it's like I've seen all facets. Just like you said, I've seen everything from like gigantic crowds to like, you know, 14 people on a Thursday night. You know what I mean? And you're like, yes, yeah, somewhere in my career, somewhere in 30 years, we've played 14 people or 27 people or 56 people or whatever. And I think all of that is just part of conditioning you and again showing you. So when you see 14,000 or 1,400, you know what I mean? Or even 140.
Yeah.
You appreciate that. You appreciate those people's time to come out and see you, especially if they're repeat offenders and they came back to see you again. Then that means it's really real. Like you love something, let it go. If it comes back, you know the deal, you know the rest.
Yeah.
It's like with that way of thinking, it's like, yeah, man, it's genuine. It doesn't feel fake. It doesn't feel like, but that's also cool to hear people be like, I never heard of you until, you know, Warped Tour. And now I'm here in, you know, wherever, Wagon Wheel, Alabama on a Tuesday night to come rap for you because, you know, I loved what you guys did. Or we seen you on the Motionless run when you guys opened for Motionless and White. And that was really cool. And it's like, it gave us a chance to get out there and any chance really and truthfully that we get. That's what's different than us than a lot of people is it's like, we love a chance to spread the word about Twiztid. We love every single opportunity. And we consider things a challenge. You know what I mean? Most bands will be like, oh, I'm out of my league. I don't know if I should know. We're like, yeah, when do we go on? Let's do this now. You know what I mean? Because it's like, if we can do what we do to a completely different crowd and they start nodding their heads and they start doing it, it means that it's universal, man. People are just putting the categories and labels on shit for the sake of it. It's all the good shit. It's all, that's what separates it. It's good shit and it's bad shit. That's the separation.
Speaking of the good shit, I do want to talk about this because it's, I know, you know, we talked about we're almost over a year removed from the live concert experience.
Sure.
Is there a show, if anyone were to ask you, I'm sure maybe someone has asked you within the last year, if there's a show that stands out at the top of your head that you can think of, I was like, man, I mean, anytime I think about this moment, it really gives me the goosebumps. Like a show that stands out, a song that performing live stands out, a fan interaction that stands out. What comes to your head when I ask you something like that?
To be honest, it's the whole entire run of the Warped Tour. Our presence, you want to talk about, you know, being the black sheep of the family. You want to talk about being the oddball. And it was like, it was almost infectious. Paul and I do what we do. And by the end of the day, people were like, whoop, whoop, you know, like, cause you're like a traveling carnival when everybody packs up, you see the same people essentially every day. And now you're getting acknowledgement from other bands that you grew up listening to. They're like, oh, it's a Twiztid dude, what's up? You know, and you're like, fuck yeah, it's cool. It's a good feeling. And I think that's the first time, at least I want to say, it's the first time that I felt that we were actually peers. That was awesome.
Yeah.
That to me is one of the greatest recognitions or shit like that. You know, I don't want it to be fake. I just want it to be real and organic. And if I am able to get what I want out of it, that's what it's all about, man. You know what I mean? To have people be like, you got to see these fucking guys. Or you look side stage and it's like, holy shit. Hey man, it's Chris Motionless. What's up, bro? You know what I mean? It's like, that's awesome, dude. It's like people, you know, showing up and representing for you, letting you know that they believe in your shit like you do. Because they can see you believe in your shit. Because it's 12:30 in the sun and you're going hard like it's 8 o'clock and it's showtime. You know what I mean? Because you want it like that. And I think it shows.
Yeah. See, little things like that when you start like it's 8 o'clock, the sun, or just something like something simple like waking up on a tour bus in the morning, you know, and hearing like the drum beat or whatever it is. They start to really stand out the more and more we call.
It does. Yeah. It really does, man. It's like it's those are times that like, you know, they seem so far away now. You know what I mean? I know we'll get back to it. I know we'll get back to it. Or what we'll do is we'll customize the new normal, whatever it may be. You know, we'll get there one step at a time. You know, I believe that. But yeah, no, that was those times are like the most recent to me. And I feel like had it would have gone on and we would have been welcome to come back again, I feel like we would be even larger or bigger than we are now. Cause I mean, that was a big portion of like two or three stairs in the staircase. You know what I mean? Like it was, you're reaching another platform, which is letting you scream louder to a bigger audience and more people are absorbing it, which is essentially what we've been trying to do since day one. It was just that, you know, life teaches you things and you learn things along your journey.
Yeah. And you know, you're talking about the staircase. As I'm thinking about that metaphorical staircase, let's talk about that step.
It's
that
a staircase. Winding staircase.
Here's the thing. Here's a step in the staircase that kind of just, it kind of throw you in for a loop. Some people have stumbled upon it, especially lately. Live streaming. A lot of the bands, what they're doing on stage, they're taking it onto the screen like we're doing right now. Right. Obviously, these interviews would be in person if there was a
way to
do that. Now, you guys did do the live streaming last week, which was amazing. Like I think I replayed it like three times. It's probably the most I've ever replayed a live stream ever since this thing has been taken over. But it's been the commonality this has been like the commonality of Interviewing a Firefly the last year. We've had so many bands that came on IUF, you know, August Burns Red did it, Lamb of God did it. A lot of the bands are talking about selling virtual tickets to the fans, you know, and then pre-recording a show or.
But I'm not mistaken. I think Korn just did it a couple nights ago.
Korn did. Yeah. What is it? Yeah, they did. Was it?
This past weekend? Recent.
Everybody's doing it. But, you know, the point I want to get to, because the amount of touring you've done throughout your career, Jamie, the amount of fans you've met, the musicians you've collaborated, the venues you've played at, the places you've been, just that list goes on and on. I want to get your take on it, because do you think that the rise of the quarantine induced live streaming we're seeing right now from all these artists, including yourself, is that going to affect the touring musician business going forward through your perspective? Like, has it already been affected? Do you still see bands doing something like this even after the pandemic is over?
Yes, I do. I personally do. I would say yes, but I also, on the other side of that coin, I can't act like I don't acknowledge that an in-person is way more intimate. You know what I mean? Whether it be, you know, 12 people in a small club and it's unplugged, you know what I mean? It's like that is more realistic than doing it live stream or doing it on a broadcast. But those things do how I look at it like this, like it's been ages since we've been to Europe or overseas and that kind of thing. And to those fans that are over there or the family that are over there that have been like, hey man, where's the love for us? It's like, I feel at least in that regard, they can get a show. They can get the show that they've much deserved and maybe missed out, or for bands that are overseas and can't come here, vice versa. I think it's what it does is it opens up. Like I look at shit like that. Like I watched lives and I'll look and I'll see the number in the corner, you know, 112 people. And it's like, that's pretty cool. Like if you have 112 people in a fucking room right now and you're talking to them, that's pretty impressive.
That's true.
It's like 2 p.m. on a fucking Wednesday. It's like people take everything for granted. Like, you know, I'm a superstar. I should just click it on. Millions of people should come. It's like they should. But if they don't, still be happy at the ones who did, because those are the real ones who are riding for you or had time at that point when you chose to go live. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
There's always the playback and shit like that. But I love that idea that you can tap in with people around the globe. But I also feel that personal show, you'll never replace that. It's not like it's a replaceable thing. You can tide people over or fill the void with what, you know, futuristic, what have you.
Yeah. Moshing in your own room if you want, for as long as you want.
You know what I mean?
As long as that.
right. You know what I mean? So it's like, I get it. But at the same time, you know, I know a lot of people are skitterish. Some people can't wait to get back. It's crazy, dude. It's going to be baby steps for a while. But like I said, I know we'll get back to normal.
I feel like I could just use it. I feel like we could just use what you just said, use it as a snippet of like of what's like, this is like the actual, like you're talking real stuff here. And
I'm with you, bro.
This as like
you said it was going to be a real conversation. God damn it. That's what we're doing.
on that note, do you guys have any plans or are you guys like brainstorming of, you know, of a actual tour, you know, after all this stuff goes down? And
to be blatantly honest with you, at this point, no. We have, and I'm looking at my notes here, I should already know it. It's Fright Fest, which is Devil's Night in Detroit, where tickets are on sale now through Live Nation. That is our first in-person deal we're going to do. Aside from that, August 20, 21st, and 22nd, which will be Astronomicon. We're still waiting on the all clear for that. You know what I mean? Because it's like, we're taking into consideration things that need to be properly looked at, like room capacity. Like, let's say you have a vendor room and only 300 people can be at there at one time. You got to do the fucking math because it's on you. So 30 vendors in there, less the 300, or you know what I mean? So it's like,
yeah,
270 people in this room at this time. So do I have to have a guy at the door with a clicker, like watching people, the head count? You know what I mean? Like we want to comply with all of the shit because we don't want nobody to come in and be like, oh, shut it down. Cause that sucks even more. You bring everybody to the door and it's time to have the party and the parents come home and you're like, no more party, bro.
Sure, right.
You know?
Yeah, and the tricky thing is like, we're also seeing other countries, like they started to go back into the normality of things. And then all of a sudden they revert back to whatever phase one was, you know, that's always
Texas is.
We're going through that here in Texas. I don't know how things are going to be like in 2 weeks, but I mean, that's a whole different discussion. We're talking about that. But what you just said, Jamie, there's no wrong answer to what you just said, because I've had so many artists come on an interview on our fire and they said something like, yeah, I would love to do live streaming. It still gives me a chance to engage with my fans. And some other artists would say, yeah, I'm not doing anything until this is over. You know, there's always that uncertainty going forward. What did I say? Mosh in your own room. You do the live streaming, right? But how much more creative can you get? There's always that wall.
I agree.
That you run into.
That was where we try to we're on the last one with the docustream, we tried to like mix in like an interview kind of deal in between it to make it a little more interesting because, you know, again, you're not going to be able to reinvent the wheel, but you can put a new tire on that motherfucker. So every now and again, we try to step it up and make it interesting because at the end of the day, we're fans of this shit too. And we want to be, our rule around here is if it's awesome, it's good. That's it.
Yeah.
Like it doesn't have to fit the musical rule of key or thumb or whatever the case, you know, like we don't go according to that shit. We're like, is it cool? Would you wear it? Okay. Yeah, go ahead. You know what I mean? It's like, that's pretty much
simple.
Yeah. Because it's like, sometimes people hold themselves to such all these extra intangible fucking things that nothing ever sees the light of day. You never take any chances because you're too busy fucking mulling over what could go wrong instead of actually just jumping and seeing what to do.
Man, speaking of jumping, we covered everything from head to toe, Jamie. Let's talk about that new album, Electric Lettuce, that came out last week on MNE. Corey, I'm gonna give it to you here because we have a lot of amazing things to say about Electric Lettuce. So, Corey, go ahead and take it.
All right. Okay. Yeah. So, okay, this is coming from the perspective of someone who doesn't smoke weed. Okay, I'm just gonna throw that out there.
Word up.
I love the album. To me, there wasn't enough. Like I wanted more. Like it was,
I love that.
It's so hip hop. It is so hip hop, true hip hop. And that's the thing. You guys don't stay in that box, right? You guys don't box yourself in. You're everywhere. It was well put together. You know, and
that's all Monoxide. I'm accepting the award for Monoxide. I'm like, thank you. He would like to thank, but I love it because it was it was a great opportunity to be like as we're consciously making this effort to be diverse in our sound, it's always nice to go back and do things to just refresh and let motherfuckers know, like, you know, like, see, check this out. Like, and I'm glad I love that you dig it. And I'm glad that you don't smoke weed and you still dig it because I don't think there's any this must be this high to ride this ride. You know, we're all good.
Right. You know, and like on that note, you know, it was a very themed album, you know, about weed, right?
So
like covering one topic. And considering that, like the creativity put into it was amazing because you didn't get bored. It was one topic and you still didn't get bored, right? Like I loved it. I absolutely loved it. My favorite song personally, because like I really got that hip hop feel. I mean, I was like, I was jamming to it in my car, just driving, and I'm like, okay, this is the one, and that's High Till I Die. That song is amazing.
That is a good ass track, dude.
That song is so amazing.
I love it. I love that you love it. Like it makes me happy because it's like, it was just one of those things where Monoxide is like, dude, 420's coming. I want to do something special. And I'm like, what do you have in mind? And he's like, how about these songs? And he just starts throwing tracks at me. And I'm like, holy shit. And it's like, again, it's like we were talking earlier. It's like that challenge. It's like, rather than say no, like, let's do this, man. Life is too short. And it was just, you can tell when, I don't know. I'm not trying to bullshit. It's like, you can tell when we're having fun. You can hear it. You can fucking hear it, dude. Or whether we're performing, you can see it. You can see when we're having a good time or when we're not. And I think it just, again, it speaks volumes in that record, the one coming up, and just like where we're at in our mind state of, you know, even though shit is fucked everywhere around us, we have to stay positive. We have to find what keeps us together and keeps us shining bright for everybody to find us.
I do wonder, when did the writing for Electric Lettuce begin for you guys? Monoxide said, yeah, I want to do an album. Here's this. Like, how easy or difficult was that process? I mean, you guys are pros at this point, you know, in your career.
It's not difficult. It's just, the only part that would be even arguably considered difficult is trying to delegate time for this or this or this. And what I just do is, because I'm constantly working on two or three things at one time, I just do like the all stop, work on what he's working on. And then I'll just like I'm in his sidecar. So like, he'll throw me what he needs me on and we'll go from there. And, you know, I'll tap in and out of things. But like, that was just the idea of the, when did I start writing it? You said?
Yeah.
shit, it would have been like maybe 3 months ago, 4 months ago,
okay,
something like that. Like it was really close to the wire. Like we were literally doing the math. Like if we could get it pressed in time to physically have it on the floor to ship and make pre-orders, because we just don't want to blow smoke up y'all ass. We'd rather be like, we can't do it. But we're like, dude, we can do it. Fuck it. Promote it. Start making the goddamn ads. And, you know, man. And it was like, yeah, dude, it worked out. We know a guy who knows a guy.
I wonder if this could be like an annual thing now, considering how well this was all put together in just a short amount of time. I mean, Monoxide's like, what, January? Hey, 420's coming up. I would like to make an album. Oh, next year. This could be like, I don't know. I'm just a fan out of millions out there, but I'm just throwing it out.
And I'm not mad at you. I think it's things like that, that like Twistmas was for a while and Fright Fest is, it's like, you know, it's things, or even Astronomicon. Well, Astronomicon, we wanted to be an annual event. I'll be honest about that. But with other things, it comes about and it hits people so hard. They're like, you have to do that again. And it becomes an annual thing. So yeah, man, I could see that totally happening. Absolutely.
Go ahead, Corey.
All right. So just to add to the, small review there, the album art was cool too. I mean, it reminded me of, I couldn't for the life of me think of what movie it was, but I want to say it's called like Reefer or something. Reefer.
Yeah.
Like it was awesome, you know.
And then, I think the concept was like an homage to Reefer Madness, I believe is what it is.
That's what it is. Reefer Madness. That's what it reminded me of.
And it was like we were dealing, what was fun, to be honest, what was fun is we were going back and working with the actual guy his name is Gary Arnett. He's responsible for doing the Freak Show cover. He's responsible for doing the Green Book cover. And it wasn't by any ill will or nothing, but we lost contact with him for like almost 10 years. And by way of the interwebs, found him again. And it was like, oh shit. And we started kicking it. And it was like, here's all the old pictures that we had. And we're like, dude, we want you to do something. Like, he's like, well, what can I do? What can I do? And we're like, do this new project, this Electric Lettuce. And he's like, well, you got to give me a bass. And you just weed. And we're like, there's a poster. You know, it's got this old, like, we want that 70s, like, evil devil weed.
That's exactly what I got. It has that vintage feeling to it, too.
Absolutely. And that's why Gary's good. He works with people like Wonder Bread and Better Made Chips and shit here in Michigan. So, like, he has that clean aesthetic to him. So it was perfect. It all fit like a hand in a glove.
The what really corresponded with the album art is your skits on there. Twiztid never lets me down with y'all skits. So it just added to that. And
I love really those.
That feel. But speaking of Freak Show, like that's my all time favorite album art. It's awesome. Matter of fact, just I don't know, you might remember this.
Yes.
So I painted that, right? Like
that's killer, dude.
And it snuck on, I had it in my hands at a show. And I was like, I want to get it signed. And one of my friends grabbed it and knocked on y'all's door. Uh-huh. Y'all's doorbell's door. And I was like, no. And then Dustin answered it. And he was like, let me take it in there. And it was in there for, I don't know, an hour. I feel like.
Jesus Christ. It was just long enough for everybody to look at it, touch it.
I didn't even know that story.
I know you were chatting with Class. So Class, he's our local hero here.
Yeah, we've interviewed Class plenty of times.
Yeah,
fair enough. No, that's awesome. Right. I just what happens with stuff like that is we'll be like, you know, just grab people's stuff if they have it and put it on the bus, and then or one guy will be there, one guy won't. So like, well, it'll hang out until then be returned back to the people. Once in a very blue moon, people will forget about it, but most people are very on top of. They're like, yo, can I have my shit? What shit? It's like, describe it. You know, it's like, it's a small painting or it's a large painting. Like, right. You know?
Yeah.
No, you guys have like a museum of like just a fan collectibles sitting.
We do, believe it or not, downstairs in the warehouse, there is an area where we have like all of the fan art. Like,
I love that.
It just keeps growing and growing. And every now and again, it's like we have to move different shit around or it gets refreshed. And it's great, man. It's cool because these people work hard on this shit. And it's just great to see it. And then you're like, God damn it. Just that'll take you back to a tour. Weird shit. Like somebody made our faces out of like paper mache. It's fucking crazy.
Holy crap. It's crazy how creative that fans can get these days.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Now, I think you briefly talked about this, but what can you tell us about your upcoming studio album, Unlikely Prescription? I don't know what you can and cannot talk about.
I can say that it is scheduled for a summer 2021 release. That is awesome. what we are fingers and toes crossed for that. Where we are right now, and the reason that I can't say an actual physical date is because we are in the process of approving mixes. Okay. Everything's recorded. The whole entire record has been recorded, and we are just sending them out, getting them back. It's close. Turn this up, turn this down. I don't like how this ends. Send it back. You know, it's like, it's the ping pong back and forth through the Pro Tools stems and shit like that. So at this point, and we are about halfway there.
Okay.
And I'm like, you guys wanna
it's crazy how time's flying, right?
I don't wanna, yeah, because it's like, it's the same thing, you know, with people's art, it's artist integrity. I don't want to step on nobody's toes. They're like, do you want perfection or do you want a rush job? And I'm like, no, I want perfect, you know, you give me the choice, yeah, sure, right. You know, but at the same time, I don't want to miss the release date. So that's why I didn't make a release date yet. But I'm hoping, like, we get there, we get like 80% of the record, we'll probably get, we'll get Randy and we'll throw out a date because we'll feel more confident about it. I just don't like telling people look for something that's not going to be there. We like to have our shit together. That's one thing we do pride ourselves on. People respect when you talk, it means something. You're not blowing fucking hot air.
And it's also good to have something like this to look forward to. I mean, you guys are making music during this crazy time, and we need Twiztid music. And hopefully that. I'm speaking for everybody out there. Now,
I appreciate
it. You know, between, you know, writing your songs and structuring, or whether it's the production process, I do wonder, because you guys have always been outside the box within your music, whether it's horrorcore or life, you know, emotions, drugs, corrupt life of Hollywood. I wonder if there's like... to what level do you guys like to have a theme for your music, and how important are themes to you, Jamie? Is that more about helping you write or sound, or is that more for the audience? Because a lot of artists, they don't really care about themes. They just do to like 10 songs in the studio and that's it. But with Twiztid, throughout your entire catalog, you guys just found a way just to be more creative and more creative, more creative. I mean, with this last record, it kind of just like, man, like there's literally no limit to what you guys can accomplish as far as that goes. Shit. You know, I do think about that sometimes. What goes inside that head of yours? Like, if you come up with a theme beforehand, or just with a go with the flow attitude.
In some senses, I mean, it's a lot different per record. A lot of them started off with concepts. Some of them did not, and some of them found their way. Like for example, Mirror Mirror was a collection of songs that were like the byproduct of coming off of the high of what was Freak Show. You know what I mean? And we knew Freak Show would be a concept album, you know, these two guys sewn together and you're different and from Dimension X and you're the angel with broken wings, walking this wasteland, trying to find your place. Who are you? Why are you here? You know what I mean? And then when we got done with that, it was like, okay, I still feel like we have work to do. You know what I mean? But it's like, we had these songs that were really cool. And it's like, a lot of people like that record because they're like, you know, I like it because it's like super duper underground and it's this EP, or is it a record or an album? We don't fucking know. And it's just dripping in mystique. And I love that. And it's like, but some of the shit like Green Book, you know, we knew we wanted the inside of the cover to look like it was a book that was checked out from the library. And we had, you know, Joe and Joey check out the book, and Jamie and Paul checked, I believe, Blake. Like, everyone had checked out that book, like part of our life. You were all a chapter in our life. And it's like, it's recorded there for all to see. And it's just, it's little cool shit like that that's special to us. You know, stuff like that kind of is meaningful even all these years after the fact, and you're all on to the next, as they say, you know, or whatever. It's like those little elements will always, you know, shine bright on those records.
Do you see your albums as snapshots of where you are in a certain time in your life looking back, Jamie?
I could say yeah. I won't deny that. Yeah, because I think that life is a process of growing, and people like to, a lot of times, you're a different person than you were yesterday. If you don't learn something every day, you're really wasting time here. You know what I mean? There's a fucking universe worth of shit for you to learn. It doesn't matter if you learn how to change a drain in a sink, or you learned how to, I don't know what the hell you learned how to do, but life is too short to not learn something every day. And it's like, I know more now than I did then. But that's the beauty of life. That's hindsight. You know what I mean? That's why they say it's always 2020, because when you're living in the now, but if you don't make those mistakes and don't make failure and everything doesn't come up roses for you every single time, you won't really know real tragedy. You won't know what it's like to have passion. That's why I think a lot of our lyrics have such a great meaning, is because it comes from our soul.
Right. And, you know, something that also came to mind as you're talking about this, you grew up in Detroit. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. Now, this is something that I'm dying to ask. I'm sure you've been asked this before. The local, mm-hmm. you know, the local music and local hip hop scene in Detroit, we all know about ICP and, of course, Eminem and Kid Rock. There's Isham and Big Sean. How has that scene, you know, how has that scene changed through your experience?
Well, it's like most of the names, the names that command that, you know, Detroit stature, are mostly like hip hop. And you got your, you know, again, like you said, you know, you got Eminem and Kid Rock and Proof, D12 and Bizarre and all those people, oh, and, gosh, Big Sean, yeah. And Big Sean and Trick, you know what I mean? And it's, yeah, like we have a lot of talent coming out of the D, but you don't necessarily hear as much the unsung heroes, there's much darker in the forest, and you got your ICPs and your Twisteds and your, you know what I mean, and your House of Krazees. And it's like, so something for everyone. It's just that our type of thing was more like, you know, the beaded section in Spencer's or the horror movie aisle. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, so
that takes me back.
Yeah. You know what I mean? So it's like, it's like something for everybody, but I think our thing was way ahead of its time. And I think our thing,
yeah,
still is ahead of its time. Although I've seen our thing become more prevalent, like American Horror Story. There's other little hits that are just common things now that are just like, you know, all of these kids, you know, wearing upside down crosses and, you know what I mean? All the weird shit. It's like people are a lot more open to shit today than they were 10 years ago or that kind of a thing. So it's like our music that used to be a shush, don't tell, put it in the closet in that old shoebox or something, is now open for everyone to see. And they're like, this is the shit, dude. Woo, woo. You know,
I kind of miss that sometimes, the exclusivity that the artists had back in the day. I miss that, you know, not everything was so accessible as it is today. And
absolutely.
I don't know. Sometimes I feel like that can get a little stale for the artist, but I mean, the point I'm trying to make is you guys have kept it fresh after all this time. And I really appreciate that.
Thank you very much, Elliot, for noticing.
I grew up in the country, like dead country. when I moved to the city. I found a friend, and he showed me some music. Matter of fact, like he showed me the Misfits, some Misfits songs and stuff. And that like really broadened my taste in music. And then, yeah, I remember one day he said, here, take this home, listen to this. And I opened the case. It was just a blank case, right? It was a CD thrown in a blank case, and it was a black album. It had two black and white faces on it. It was Most Tasteless, right? So, like he said, just go listen to that. Tell me what you think.
That was the Jive re-release, right?
Yeah.
The Bottle Rock the Dead. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I remember like, what the hell, like how have I missed this, you know, like this isn't, you can't hear this on the radio. So like I do remember it was, to me, it was like you know, opening up a whole new box, right? Whole new box of a different variety. So yeah, it was kind of like hidden, but so I think my friend Tun, I think back to him and I'm like, you know, hey, thanks for really broadening my,
putting me on. Yeah, no, for real. Yeah. Putting me on. That's how some of the shit was when we were growing up. It was like, it's a crazy thing, but like the Jerky Boys, when we were originally coming up, you heard about the Jerky Boys as word of mouth. There was no internet. You couldn't just type in Jerky Boys and it would be their whole catalog. It was like you had to buy the cassettes, or you would get the cassettes so you could put your homies on it. You gotta hear this. This is fucking great. And before you know it, everybody got a hold of it, and it kind of lost its specialness. And that was a good lesson, just to see that, just to see how something can, the word of mouth can just get this great big attention to you. But then at the same time, it's like, once everybody has it and nobody wants it anymore, then was it that special? That's the part. I mean, I still laugh with it. I still have a great time with it, but I just, there was something that it showed me that like, you can actually have that word of mouth really, really propel you into, hey, this right here. Well, with that record you were talking about, that was a great time for us too, because that was the actual time that we were able to come up a couple rungs in the ladder and fuck with Island Def Jam at that time. Oh, yeah. We thought we were like, oh man, we didn't think we made it, but we knew we were on the fucking right road to wherever it is or was. You know what I mean? So that, yeah, man, that was a killer time too.
You know, Jamie, from the different experiences and perspectives in your timeline you've taken in, which we've discussed about so far, you know, over 15 records in over 3 decades, you know, spending majority of that sharing the stage with the Monoxide, and of course the worldwide touring cycles we mentioned you've completed, and the dedicated fan base that you guys have had all this time, you know, what is the most rewarding part for someone like you, who is now at this point in their career, at the same time has been involved with so many other different aforementioned talented bands, artists, individuals throughout that said timeline? You know, you've experienced so much already and then some. Do you ever stop just to take a look back at how far you've come? Like, did all that just play a part in helping Jamie grow as an artist and as a person?
Sometimes I stop, but it's very briefly, because we talk about this, like George and I talk about this, Paul and I talk about this, and it's like the cliche thing, stop to smell the roses. And it's like, I say to them at times when everything is like, fuck, man, what the fuck, you know, because it's like it's piling up, and I'm like, just wait, we're making history right now, it's fucking history. And they'll just be like, you're fucking insane. And I'm like, I'm telling you, we're making history right now. And then like, we'll wait a couple while, and then we'll, you know, when you guys did that was great. And I'm like, see, I fucking told you. But it's like, I try not to let that's my way of not letting pressure and all the fuckery get on top of me. I asked for this job. So yeah, this is what I want.
Yeah. I think it's important to think about that, because I like asking that question, because it's also easy to lose track of yourself the more successful you are. It's also important to just kind of push everything the fuck back and just look at it from the outside before you step back into it. Just remind yourself about why you do what you do, and the reason behind everything that is, you know, well put, Jamie here. So now this is the last part of the interview. I know you said, I told you we're going to have a surprise for you. I think we're on a good roll here. So what I'm going to do, okay, Jamie,
yes, sir,
I'm going to put you on the hot seat. Hot seat. We're going to see if you know the lyrics to your own songs. Are you up for that challenge?
Oh shit.
You got a lot of songs, right? We're not going to obviously, you know, list them all. That would take
here we go.
So what we did, we handpicked a few. Me and Cory went over this over and over and over a few nights ago. We're like, okay, what do we ask him? So what are we gonna do? We're gonna start you off easy, I promise. I'm gonna read a lyric. And here's the thing, when you read a lyric, it's different. If you think about it, the delivery that you guys have on stage is a whole different perspective as opposed to just us reading it. Cause it's like, it's like poetry. I feel like I'm reading it to like a kid, you know, just like helping him fall asleep, you know, something like that, like a bedtime story. So what I'll do, I'm going to read a lyric. You name the song. This kind of ties into like the chicken wings. Like, so you would go, a hot sauce level higher.
I don't have to say the lyrics. I just have to name the song.
All right. That's easy. Okay. There we go.
And we'll see what happens.
Me and Cory will alternate. I'll start things off.
Oh shit. Here we go.
A cloudy haze of my days. So high, I need Robert Seeger to turn the page. I think that's all I even need to read. I think you got this one. So I can smoke and sip and mull over the shit that I'm supposed to get paid.
It's on electric lettuce.
Yeah,
I know that.
Cory talked about this, actually.
Yeah, I talked about this. Yeah,
specifically this song.
Oh man,
Jamie, you put you on the spot here already.
Yeah, man. The titles of the songs are the weakness to me. I knew that. I was going to say, all over the shit I'm supposed to get paid. God damn it. Hey, who got the electric lettuce track list? God damn it.
This is great. I've had so many artists who say, I'm not going to get any song, and they get every song right. And then when they say, yeah, I'll get every song, and they get every song wrong, it's always the opposite. It's never like...
Yeah, man.
Think back to my favorite song on the album.
I know, that's the thing. And I'm thinking of what you said, and I'm like, fuck, dude, we talked about so much shit.
Right.
Let me see. Hold on. I'll go grab a fuck. If I grab the CD, I'll tell you which one it is.
That counts.
That counts?
That counts, yeah.
Go ahead. Get out. Hold on. I'll be right back. Holy shit. Hey, who got the goddamn electric light?
Oh, my God. This is great.
It is great.
All right. You got the next one, Corey. You know that, right?
Yeah.
We'll alternate. Jamie's gone.
Next one's a good one.
All right, everyone. Jamie's back here. He's coming back.
I'm looking. Yep. I don't know. I know it's not We All Float. I know that much. God damn it. Next one. Corey, I'll take the L. Keep pushing.
Corey, what is it?
High till I die.
All right.
It's already over now. They gave me like a 10-second buffer zone to go and actually cheat. I had a fucking phone a friend, and you let me down. Go ahead. That's fine.
All right, Corey, you got the next one.
All right, you bring me up and take me down. Life magic smacks spell. The face. I'm sorry.
Oh wow, he already got that. Go. He got that.
Magic spell. See,
that one is that song is so amazing.
Generation
way.
Nightmare.
I have time spent with that one. We performed that one a good time around the block. So yeah.
Guys, you didn't even finish. You didn't even finish the first line. Yeah, Jamie already got that.
Because right. I feel like my integrity is on the line, gentlemen.
I purchased the vinyl, right? And I just barely opened it. I don't have a vinyl player. So like, I just barely opened it and I saw how freaking awesome the picture art is on there. I was showing Sonny the other day. What the heck happened?
His light turned off. All right. Let me.
It's a dark carnival, I promise. Here we go.
Shunned all my life like I'm plagued and diseased. Rather live on my feet than die on my knees. It's just like poetry reading this over and over. It's great.
I'll tell you this, like
it's
hold on. Think 2012.
I was gonna say it was Independence Day.
No.
Or no, I take that back. That's Abomination. Lyric. That's from yeah. Abomination.
Yeah, the title track.
It's from Abominations.
I'm trying to triangulate the song.
He's got it though. That's the
name of the album. And yeah.
It's the name of the album and the song.
The title track.
Ah, oh, well, and you were, all right, whatever.
That counts. He got it though.
No, I won't even take that one.
I'll give it to him.
All right.
That was such a fast lyric
God
though.
Damn it. Show you how tacky I am. I'll take it.
Those vocals were so fast. I remember picking that album up in Oklahoma.
I knew it was Paul. I knew it was Paul that you were quoting, and I was like, and I'm trying to think because I know it, like that was passionful shit, and I'm like trying to figure out what mind state that was, and I was like,
that one was your lyric there.
Oh, was it?
Yeah, that's the. Don't laugh at me here because I can't go as fast as you. But you say, "Shun to my life and a plague and a disease," and you know, blah blah blah, like super fast.
For the live of my life, to die. Yeah. Okay, you're right. Watch me. God damn it.
That song, freaking me on my man. I fell down and
never again. Go ahead.
Here's the thing. If anything, when you guys come back to Dallas, I'm making you rethink your set list. So there's that.
Fair enough. Or at least I'm getting them tattooed, the names of them tattooed. Jesus H. All right, Corey. Cool. We got one more or no?
We got one more if you want. We have a whole bunch.
More. I feel like there's a tiebreaker there. I'm one for I got one horribly wrong, one we horribly got, right, one I'm, one.
We got like six songs left.
Yeah, but we can do like two more if you're cool with that.
Let's do two more. Do two okay. more.
All right, just, Corey.
Here we go. One.
All right. Bloody bodies in the bathtub for over two whole weeks.
And it's ha ha ha.
There you go. Like that right. was another one. That was,
he
you know,
brings it
away.
Back for himself. And now this last one.
All right. I'll let you pick.
That's why we're center of the mix, center of attention. So many levels of my mind's dimension. Inquisitive minds always asking questions. Shoot them all down. That will lose attention. God, I love reading that. This is fun to read.
This is another fast lyric.
Yeah, this is definitely, I want to say again, from Abominations.
You actually said this title before.
Yeah.
Oh, did I really?
Yeah. That time you got it wrong, but if you said it now. 2007.
It was Independence Day. Let me think.
You mean to read it again?
Say it again one more time.
Corey, read it.
Okay. That's why we're center of the mix, center of attention, so many levels to my mind's a dimension.
Is it Barry Amal?
Yes. Got yes. it.
All right. Yeah. You know what? Jesus Christ. I knew half of them.
Hey, we'll get you next time, man. Jamie, this has been such an honor. We don't want to keep you for too long, but man, do you have any last words, any shout outs, anything you'd like to plug in as far as Twiztid, Electro Lattice, or anything coming up in the near future before we finish things off here for all the fans and followers who are listening?
The Astronomicon weekend, August 20, 21st and 22nd, Fright Fest Live in Detroit on Devil's Night. Tickets live, ticket at livenation.com right now. Thank you to Real and Cory for having me on the show. I appreciate y'all's time. Thank you to everybody watching this right now. And just remember, some bands actually still do give a shit, mad shit about y'all. So it's worth the time to invest in a motherfucker that love you back. Appreciate y'all, man. Y'all have a good day.
Love you, Jamie. You take care.
All right, take care, bro.
All right, we'll talk to you later, man.
All right, take care, man. Screaming, switch it now, change the day, and take whatever comes my way. I gotta say that this magical spell is heaven and hell. When it pays, it can lighten the darkness of your day. Wish it away. You need me up in times when I wanna die. Intoxicated by your magic spells, you wave all the time. You bring me down. Hey guys, thanks for listening to Interview Under Fire podcast. If you guys liked what you heard, please subscribe and share our channel. And please leave a 5-star review, as that helps us tremendously. If you'd like to check out more, visit www.interviewunderfire.com or our social media channels on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. And finally, we want to thank you all for the support you've been giving us. Keep it burning.